If you are joining us for worship, whether that is right now live or watching this later on Facebook or maybe just watching the sermon on YouTube, you are, by just the nature of the way we are worshiping, doing so through a computer. And in this season of our worship being in a computer and our fellowship being on Zoom and all sorts of different ways that we are connecting digitally, I am guessing that most of you have experienced your screen freezing up or your feed freezing up. It happens every week. I'm in some kind of Zoom meeting and whoever's talking stops moving. And then we wait to see if they're going to come back, and maybe they do, maybe they have to disconnect and reconnect. But this idea of our screens freezing up, of our feeds freezing up, is something that is just a part of our time that we spend together in these days. Today we heard a story from 1 Kings. And in that story, Elijah has frozen up. Elijah was a prophet. And not only was he a prophet, he was a prophet who was sent to say, as prophets often are, unpleasant truths to the king. King Ahab was the king of Israel, and the book of 1 Kings tells us that he was worse than all of the ones who came before him. He married a woman from a foreign land and worshipped her god Baal and built altars and tore down the altars of the Lord and built these sacred poles and did evil in the sight of the Lord. Before we find Elijah in the cave that we do today, he is a few years earlier had to tell Ahab that a drought is coming. In the narration of the story, you figure out that Ahab probably spent a few years looking for Elijah to get rid of him. He eventually comes back at the behest of God to tell Ahab that the drought is over. But he then has like a prophet showdown with the prophets of Baal. And eventually, Jezebel, the king's wife, gets so mad that she is seeking to have Elijah killed. And so he runs out into the wilderness. After years of drought and famine, he now is on the run. And as our story opens, he has taken up hiding in a cave. And a word from the Lord comes to him and says, Elijah, why are you here? What are you doing? And his answer is basically, I'm hiding. But that's not how he says it. He says, I've been zealous for the Lord, and the people of Israel have not been faithful. They've torn down your altars, they've killed your prophets, and now they're seeking to kill me. But we know Elijah is frozen up like a screen, right? We know that his feed has frozen because later when God shows up to speak with him, the same question gets repeated. Elijah, what are you doing here? And he says the same exact thing. I'm hiding, right? He says, I've been zealous for the Lord and the people of Israel have not been faithful and they've killed your prophets and now they're coming to kill me. Whatever conversation Elijah has had with God along the way, whatever work he has done, we find him hiding in a cave, the feed having frozen up, he having frozen up. He only has one answer. It's the only thing he can say. He doesn't have anything else. He's stuck in that cave, fearing for his life as death is near. In this time of pandemic, death is near to us as well. Death is near as we see the virus that is killing people, normal stuff that brings death into our lives. But also just a whole bunch of little deaths. As school gets ready to start, there is much to lament about traditions that aren't unfolding as school year begins. There is much to lament about the death of our normal day-to-day routines and other things that have come in their places. All around us are things to grieve and lament that are the things of death. And amidst that, it is easy for us to freeze up, just like Elijah freezes up. When Elijah freezes up, right, he gets called to the mouth of the cave where the Lord is going to meet him, and we are told that there is a wind and an earthquake and a fire. These are ways that Elijah in the past, especially the wind and the fire, has heard the Lord. In the stories with Ahab, there's one where Elijah calls upon the fire of the Lord to come down. And then when the drought is over and the rain is going to come, we hear that there's this rushing sound of rain and then a great wind that brings in the clouds. Elijah is used to hearing God in fire and in wind. And when those things come in that cave, though, that's not where he hears God. His old way of hearing God isn't working in this space where he is frozen up. And as we are near death in the way that he was, and by near death I mean close by death, we too can freeze up. I have to tell you, already twice this morning, I misplaced my phone wandering around the church. I've left my keys at home a couple of times. More often than not, I find myself searching for names or words or ideas that will not come to me. And some days it just feels like my brain is freezing up on me out of just exhaustion and the effort it takes to live in this time where everything is new and different. My prayer life has had some things freeze up as well. For those of you that have been around Salem the past couple of years, you've heard me talk probably a fair bit about contemplative prayer. And it took me like four decades to figure out that my best prayer practice is to just sit and be quiet. 20 minutes at least once a day of sitting and just trying to listen for what it is that God would speak. And for a good while, that had been a really fruitful prayer practice for me, including on Sunday mornings. I would come to this worship space very early in the morning, well before I needed to be here, just to have enough time to sit in that space of silence, of asking God to show up and make something happen with us, but then to just be quiet and listen in preparation for worship. And I have to tell you, in all of this time of pandemic, I still get here early enough in the morning to do that 20 minutes of praying, but most weeks it doesn't happen because the routines of getting ready for worship now are so different that I find myself just getting barely ready in time for us to get started. And that contemplative practice that I have has frozen up. It has not been a part of my prayer life in these days. And my guess is that you too have had things in your life, whether it's searching for a name or losing your phone or your keys, or it's your prayer life that has frozen up in some way. We are nearby the things of death, and right now, with everything being in chaos and new and different, it is easy for it to end up in those frozen up places. And like Elijah, if God were to show up and say, "What are you doing?" and we would just probably have the same answer each day, an answer that comes from that place of being frozen. Now, in this story, though, as Elijah has that same answer, and as Elijah is not hearing God in the fire and the wind in the ways that he so recently has, God gets his attention in a new way. God speaks to Elijah in a new way. In the NRSV translation we heard today, it's called the sound of sheer silence. In the King James Version, it is called a still small voice. And in that sound of sheer silence and that still small voice, Elijah hears that it is God, and he comes out and covers his face. And then what does God do? God asks him that question, right? What are you doing here? What are you doing, Elijah? Elijah has that same stuck answer, but in asking that question that has already been asked, God is giving Elijah an opportunity to speak his reality, to talk about how he is stuck, to give voice and lament to the things that have left him frozen. But God, who has gotten his attention in this new way, doesn't leave him frozen. God doesn't leave him stuck. God actually gives him work to do. And it sounds like terrible work. He has to bless a king of Aram, a group that was at war often with the people of Israel. He has to bless and anoint a new king of Israel and then a prophet to take his place. At this point, a new prophet might have been a welcome thing for him. But then we're told that this king of Aram is going to bring the sword, and then whoever he doesn't kill, then Jehu, the king of Israel, is going to come and get, and whoever he doesn't get, then Elisha is going to come and get. And it sounds like what the Lord is inviting Elijah to do is to anoint this time of death dealing. But if you take a step back into the bigger picture, right, what happened at this time with Elijah is that Ahab was not a faithful king. He was a horrible king. And in that space, there were those who were oppressed and those who were killed. And so what God is asking Elijah to do is bless something new. Bless a new opportunity for faithfulness for the people of Israel. Bless some option for them to get away from their unfaithfulness and live into a place of new life and faithfulness. Now, whether they actually are successful at that or not, it's very much up to their own choices. But Elijah's task is to go and bless the new opportunity for life. So God gives him a chance to speak his lament, talk about how he's stuck, and then blesses him, gives him work to do to go bring a new blessing of life into the world. This is how God often works. This is what happens with Jesus. when we get to the death of Jesus. Death is close by, and Jesus speaks his own reality, right? My God, why have you forsaken me? He cries out for the cross. He has his own lament. But then God anoints him, blesses him to go and be the one that ushers resurrection life into the world. So as we sit in our time, however we might be frozen up, we can expect that God is going to do the same thing that God did for Elijah and did for Jesus. First, to get our attention in some new ways. My contemplative prayer practice has been all frozen up, and I suspect if I could sit in that space, it would be fruitful yet again. But God has found other ways to speak to me. Much of it is in the ways that you all share things with me. One of you wrote a psalm that was beautiful. Others have asked questions or followed along with the psalms that we've been sharing each day. And there's so many different ways that those blessings have been shared with me. And all of that I experience as God speaking in a new way to get me unstuck, to unfreeze the screen. And I hope that you too are hearing God speak to you in new ways. And if you haven't yet, that is okay, because that just means we're in that cave with Elijah, in that place where we only have that answer to God's question that says, I'm stuck, I'm hiding, I don't know what to do. But we trust that the God of new life will get our attention in some way, will speak to us in new ways. And then when God does speak to us, gives us an opportunity then to speak our stuckness, to talk about the ways that things have frozen up, to give that lament. We're going to take a moment to do that right before we say the Lord's Prayer today. Earlier this week, I posted on our Facebook group a request for parents and teachers and grandparents to share their laments as we get ready to start school. And those laments, that's us speaking our stuckness, right? That's us giving voice to the pain and the struggle that has us frozen up in a cave. But then God gives us work to do. Just as God blessed Elijah to go try to bless new life into the world, and just as God blessed Jesus to go through death and bring new life into the world, God blesses us to bring new life into the world. I don't always know what that looks like, because each of us is in this way in lots of different geographies and spaces. But surrounding us here, a school for some of us starts tomorrow as kids head back to college. As some of you work from home or work in environments that are altogether different than they used to be, God calls us to go into those places and be a blessing. How we do that, right? It all depends on where we are and who we're coming into contact with. But it may just be that we are the ones that are invited to speak that word that invites people to speak their own lament. Maybe we are the ones that are the still small voice and that sound of sheer silence that give people an opportunity to speak their reality, but then invites them into new ways of being in this time of difference and distance and so much else that is going on. I don't know always how that is going to look, because the work of God is always unfolding new among us, but I do trust that just as Elijah was called out of that cave and just as Jesus was called out of the tomb, that we too are called out of our frozenness. So whatever way you are frozen up, whether it's in your worship, in your prayer, in your day-to-day, know that God is not done with us, that we can speak our realities and trust that God is calling us into the world to bless others, and along the way we will experience God's grace, a gift that is always coming to us. We don't have to ask for it. We don't have to work for it. It is ours, and God is going to drag us to new places altogether. Amen.